Hello, dear ones. It's Alice. I'm of the stars. And just I have a few archetypal images to talk about and their use in protecting us. These archetypal images were the foundation, some of the foundation for the creation of the human species. And they can be used to protect us from other people's subconscious expression of the feral drives, as everything is set in place for new life on New Earth. During this interval, they can protect us from thought forms. Coming up in the first section on sacred sexuality are the symbols for the divine feminine and the divine masculine. And the most important current use for these is the prevention of astral rape by both men and women. So that's section one coming up right now. The first symbol that I'd like to talk about is the symbol of the feminine, the divine feminine. This is the seagull symbol for the sacred feminine. There are clearly two wings as if taking flight, and they also represent the open, inviting legs of a woman. And in the center is the spot, the V-shaped spot, for entry point for the penis. And it also represents the yoni, the cup, the cup that may be filled with water. The second symbol of the divine feminine it's like a little tree seen from above, like a black tree shape, which symbolizes the mound of Venus with the pubic hair on it, followed by a diamond shape, the outline of a diamond shape, which indicates to me the spot where the vagina is, the point of entry for the penis, and it also indicates the precious nature of that offering and that possibility. And here it is. So for this archetypal image of sign of a woman, I can think of two possible good uses for it. One would be for a woman to attract a man that she wants as a partner, and the other would be for a woman to use for herself to protect and nurture her own sexuality. A little more on this female symbol, the symbol for, that looks like a seagull, that's a symbol of femininity. I found out just now that this symbol can be projected by a woman to prevent astral rape by another woman as requested by a man for her to do that. First, I'd like to fill you in a little on one of these wide-ranging malware programs that have been going on until now that are not quite resolved yet either. This has been an age that has turned to patriarchy from the balance of the masculine and the feminine. That is the norm and the ideal. And one of the symptoms of this age of patriarchy that has just ended and is being cleared out and cleaned up is that when a man on the astral plane, in the astral negative, in the world of the collective unconscious, asks a woman to do something, if that woman has had sexual relations with him on the physical plane at some time during her current lifetime, then she has not yet risen to unity of the lower mental body and the higher mental body, her lower mental body will be operating is part of the collective unconscious or collective subconscious of humankind. In other words, she won't be aware of what's happening. Same for the man, if he's not yet unified mind. So what happens over and over again is that this man, who may or may not be married to this woman, but has had some like bonding that has not cleared with her. This is not to say that the bonding cannot clear, but that it frequently has not cleared. And in these cases, this happens, okay? The man asks the woman to woo another woman on the astral plane. This is because he himself finds that he can't attract this woman, and he wants to control this second woman. Okay, so he asks the woman to do that for him. And so then what you feel as the second woman, you feel an attempt at astral rape by a woman. All unconscious, all subconscious, happening over and over again, right? So the thing to do, which I just found out, is to use this symbol of the seagull, the symbol of the woman flying and noble as a sexual gender symbol, and project that to the woman that is unconsciously doing the bidding of the man. And this causes her to align in sisterhood with you. This is therefore an extremely useful and helpful tool in bringing the balance back to sacred sexuality on Earth. On to the next archetypal image or marker has to do with a man's genitals. It's very simple. It looks like three U's. The middle U is a little bit bigger, and they're all conjoined. It looks like this. Very clearly, this symbol represents the Shiva Lingam. In fact, three, one in the being the largest. And might be said to represent the Trimurti or the Trinity. You can flash as well. This archetypal image in the case of astral rape gangs roaming around you that you can't get rid of. Anytime you have a very insistent attempt at astral rape, you can use it. I advise not using it often because the effect is upsetting to the person that sees it. So it basically threatens their manhood, and no man likes that feeling. So if you must use it, then use it only once. For this sign of the masculine, I can think of two uses besides protection of a woman. What it really means when a woman projects this symbol, this archetypal image, if she's single and if she needs protection, or if a child uses it, it means that she or the child are under the protection of a man. And so the astral rape gangs need to leave, that there's danger there for them, and they do leave right away. But there are other uses besides protection for this symbol. It can be used by a man to affirm his masculinity with the woman that he loves. And in particular, it could be used by the man as a projected mental image during the sex act with his beloved. And that, in many cases, I think he will find that enhances the experience of sexuality. Now I'd like to discuss some more symbols that are very ancient and have great power for good in the world, but which are not markers. They're not instinctual markers. They're deeply subconscious archetypal images that are not biological markers. Regarding the feral drive to aggression, if we sense that energy on the psychic plane, the suggestion is to visualize an outline of gently lapping waves of water. This might be very beneficial, in fact, because it indicates a continuity of feeling, a flow, getting in the flow, going with the flow, and the quality of water to wash one's cares away. So I think this is an excellent suggestion. The next symbol that I have today is the circle with the cross in it, and it looks like this. This symbol is used in Christian churches today. In fact, it's a stylized image of the halo that I saw recently in church, just behind and above the head of Christ. And actually, this same symbol was suggested by Thoth in Egyptian times in Doriel's version of the Emerald Tablets, the cross inside of a circle. So what this provides is protection against negative astral entities and evil occurrences and so forth. It's like a blessing and a shield. And so you can imagine it at the top of your head or like lying flat above your head, like a disc lying flat above your head. It prevents negative astral entities, such as demons and so forth, from entering your hara line there. These days we don't need that so much because the lines are clear between our physical body and as far as Source, God itself, all the way down to Earth, everything. So we don't need it now, but in the Dark Ages it's very much needed. And so the Dark Age just passed in December 2012, and now we're in the Age of Light, thank God. And so, but if you do need it, if you find that you're being tempted or tested by, say, Satan or any of his dark angels, you can use that. You can just draw the picture, put it on a piece of paper, and put it on your chest, or you can imagine it. It will work just as well. Next, I have the circle. The circle is a very powerful symbol of the all, known from the very beginning, before these gender differences were known. The circle allows us, when we imagine it, to connect with the entire universe, even the multiverse, all that is, and to know that all is one and one is all. And it looks like this. So that's a symbol to allow a person to feel unity or harmony with all creation. Two twined snakes have been for long ages the sign of the vortex and of the kundalini energy, that is the vortical energy of humankind. This is seen in the caduceus, I think it's called, the symbol of medicine. And the reason it's in the symbol for medicine is that that a well-maintained kundalini energy, an open, clear channel there, keeps a person in perfect health for a very long time, for a long lifetime. So this vortical energy, this caduceus energy, this twining snakes, or this crisscrossed, intertwined vortex energy, is also represented in the writings of Thoth, the Emerald Tablets, as translated by Doriel, as the circle. You'll recall from the earlier discussion of the circle that the circle represents the all, and the circle is also a cross section of the vortex, and the vortex allows us to communicate with the all, with our star brothers and sisters. The circle is a cross section of the twined kundalini energy. And this circle, which also represents the vortical forces, allows a person to escape from the third dimension. It, as it were, drills a hole in it. It creates a wormhole. It it allows our stargate at the crown chakra and below the feet to open, so that we can make contact with the core of Earth, all of the most physical, most dense part of Earth, and also with Source on the way up. So this is a very important sign, the circle. Next is a section on symbols regarding free will, and this section is especially pertinent during the Dark Ages, which are not now. Now is the Age of Light, and has to do with transmission of thoughts during the Age of Darkness and ways to get around mind control during those times. Angles. I've spoken of angles before. Angles are the way that communications take place on Earth when they are unable to pierce through the highest levels of the stratosphere, such as noospheric energies, thought forms, emotional thoughts of humankind hit the very top barrier of that region and ping back to Earth like radio signals. In the past, the negative astral beings used this striking force of thought forms in ways that I can't describe too well. But you could think of a pool table and how the projected pool balls ratchet off of the sides of the table and go off in another direction. And you can see how negative astral beings might use negative thought forms to influence various geographical areas on Earth during the Dark Ages. Thankfully, that time is not now. This is the Age of Light. All right, here's another one regarding mind control. There's a symbol in the minds of people who unconsciously do mind control, and that is water relentlessly surging on and through someone else's mind, like a great wave surging through someone's mind. And to counteract this notion, I suggest turning that wave into a circular motion. Turn that wave into a gently circling wave of water. That way it'll lose its forward impetus. So in your mind, you visualize that. I've mentioned before that sometimes in regard to mind control, people visualizing placing a weight on someone else's top of their head, or sitting themselves on top of someone's head, or placing a hard hand down on top of someone else's head, so that as if their mind couldn't produce any thought forms, you know, to like contain their mental mind, their higher mental mind. And my solution to that is not a symbol, but just a saying, as they say, my mind to your mind, you say, your mind to the mind of God. That's very simple, and it creates the feeling that weight that you might feel psychically on top of your head is really God touching the top of your head. And so the energy of the unconscious mind control turns to a conscious energy of awareness, divine awareness. I was thinking just now about the Native American traditions for fertility of women, fertility of the land, and for abundance for the peoples, the nations. And I believe very generally held is the symbol for an ear of corn, maize, and the legend of the corn goddess. So here's a good symbol to use as a clear projection for a blessing of abundance for oneself and for other people, the ear of corn. these symbols, I would not just give them round anywhere, you know. They're important symbols, and they're the beginning of a vocabulary of light that will allow us to co-create reality very quickly and with great blessings of light. So that's what I have for you right now. I wish you the very best. When I get new intel, I'll be sure and let you know.